Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. This show has been altered to conform with YouTube's rules on copyright. I hope you enjoy it, and God bless you and yours.
Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
And welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. This is the last lair on Dream Stream Radio. Thursday, I'll have one last music box, and it's time to call it a day. TC is very ill, and Zach is struggling, and the gracious thing to do is stop it now. Stop the bleeding. And I am thrilled beyond words to have John Allen Savolaine as my last guest on Dream Stream. My plan is to do interviews and put them straight to YouTube and maybe look for another source. You know, during the summer, check out some other options. But this will be the last show for Dream Stream Radio, and we're taking a small hiatus and get ourselves together. And I want to thank Dream Stream Radio for being wonderful. And Zach and I, he's always going to be a second son to me. And TC, I'm hoping you can fight your way through this, buddy. But the story tonight is about the 1916 Matawan shark attacks. Now, my aunt was the first of our family to come to America and buy a house, and I'm using parentheses in this. It was a bungalow in Lawrence Harbor, and back in the day, people came from the city and rented those bungalows for $8 a week. They didn't have heat, or else they had one of those one-piece floor heaters in the floor, and she bought that house. And then, of course, the rest of the family started migrating, and I ended up renting a house in Cliffwood Beach. And it was also, at one time, a bungalow that people rented for $8 a week. And this was in 1973. The floor had a really funky smell in it, you know? And I was like, what the heck is that smell? And I scrub it, so finally I made the decision to rip up the oilcloth, and what they used for insulation was newspapers. And I started reading these newspapers, which were in perfect condition because they had been between wood and the oilcloth, and it was all about this shark attack that happened not 4 miles from where I lived. And it was the 1916 shark attack. And these were all papers from those weeks, from all through July, explaining about how a shark was moving up the New Jersey coast and ended up in Matawan Creek. And that was my fascination. And then, of course, Jaws came out. And I said, yeah, and tell me this guy didn't rip this story off from history. I gave it to an ex-in-law who said she'd find out what they were worth. She did, and I never saw her again. That's one of I would still have those newspapers. Our guest tonight is historian and now an incredible author, John Allen Savolaine, who has written a book about the shark attacks and the unknown hero of the shark attacks. And Al Savolaine, welcome to my lair.
Glad to be with you, Mo.
This is something I know that you have been working on a long time, and you've always felt since I've met you that Stanley Fisher was an unsung hero who needed to get the proper recognition.
Very much so. And that When I came to New Jersey about the same time you were moving down in this area, I became fascinated with this story about the Matawan shark attack. I'd always been a history buff, and so I'd known about the attacks in 1916, but I didn't have all the particulars about what happened to Matawan until I actually moved to Matawan in the early 70s and became a member of the Matawan Historical Society. And I started talking to people who actually knew your family and their relatives, and it was so unusual, not just the fact that someone had been killed by a shark, but that a shark had come in the tidal creek all the way up to Matawan, and in such a dramatic way. You know, this man had given his life, and really he had given his life to recover the body of a young boy who had been attacked a short time earlier. That made it even more fascinating. And being a history buff, it just the more I researched this, the more I understood that this was a different time period. And these people, you know, in this small town, they had a very special connection with each other. And that the people who, Stanley Fisher died during this incident, but there are other people who were also in the water, you know, knowing that a shark was there, risking their lives to recover this body. And that really fascinated me. And through the years, I tried to find out as much as I could about this young man, Stanley Fisher, who the more that I read about, the more fascinating a character he became. And very little had been written about him, about his personal life, his background, his attitudes, his private life. Nothing had been written, really. And that's what I wanted to add with my book, because this is like new turf that hasn't been dealt with before. And I felt with all the work that I'd spent over the years, I wanted to add this to people who were interested in this particular incident.
The book's name is Stanley Fisher, Shark Attack Hero of a Bygone Age: How Brave Men Faced a Relentless Killer Shark in a Small New Jersey Town the Summer of 1916, by John Allen Savolaine. Now, what I think is hard for people to grasp is we judge history by our standards. And I posted this a couple of weeks ago, but they were not the standards of the day. Most houses did not have a phone in them. Most houses had a radio, and you didn't sit and listen to it all day. You were out working, gardening, growing food, doing whatever it was, the wash and that kind of thing. So it was a different, completely different era. And so when we think of it, well, how could this have happened? It was a saltwater, freshwater creek. And up till then, nobody recalled a shark going up that far, because it's like 12 miles from the ocean into this, right?
It's 12 miles literally from the open ocean, from Sandy Hook down to Cape May, which most people consider the Jersey Shore. But it's only 1.5 miles from Raritan Bay.
Right.
So technically, it's very close to the ocean, but most people think of it, inland bay, as opposed to being.
Yeah, I don't look at it as a bay. I go there and look and see, the ocean, you know?
It is the Atlantic Ocean.
Yeah, I mean, I go into Keyport and look and go, yeah, that's the ocean, you know? It's so, the time. Tell us about Matawan at the time. It's this sleepy little, it used to be a huge fishing village, metropolis.
Matawan really goes back in history. It was actually founded in 1686, you know, actually long before the American Revolution. And it was called Middletown Point back in those days. And people at that time took advantage of Matawan Creek. They had, in fact, Monmouth County was one of the wealthiest agricultural counties, you know, in New Jersey. But they needed a shipping point, you know, to take these goods, in the 18th century, there were schooners and sloops were ocean-going type vessels. They needed, you know, transport goods. And Matawan Creek at that time, it's about a mile and a half from Raritan Bay, but it was a tidal creek, and it was over 20 feet deep at high tide. So some of these, you know, larger ships actually came into Matawan, and they loaded, you know, loaded up with their agricultural goods, brought other manufactured goods down from New York City and other coastal areas to Matawan. And Matawan had only had, in those days, only had about 1,500 people in 1916. And before that, actually had fewer people. It was just a village along this, in fact, the locals call it the Crick. Mm-hmm. Matawan Creek, they call it the Crick.
And, yeah, when I came down here, that's what they called it.
Exactly. And the advantage was it was deep. It was a tidal creek coming in, so they could actually bring in ocean-going ships and, you know, take their goods up to, you know, to New York, to Boston, and points north or south down to Charleston and Savannah. And it, in fact, even in the 18th century, you had a number of wharfs along the creek. And then in the 19th century, almost 200-foot steamboats came into Matawan Creek. And this was it was very, very prominent as a commercial waterway before the railroad came to Matawan in 1875. Then actually, after 1875, it wasn't quite as much for transporting, different types of goods, because now they had the railroad. But before the railroad, it was a major waterway. And there were a number of, back in those days, a number of sea captains that lived in Matawan. And a lot of people, would bring their goods from Monmouth County, and they would, in fact, we had several grist mills in Matawan, and they would grind up the corn and the wheat into sacks of flour. They had warehouses along Matawan Creek, and they would load the ships, and a lot of material, went up to New York. In the 19th century, Matawan was also very prominent because we had almost a half dozen brickyards in Matawan. A lot of the skyscrapers you see in New York City, the bricks actually came from Matawan to build. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of things were shipped through Matawan Creek, from the brickyards and things like that. We also had several small factories located in Matawan. So it wasn't really what you call a typical shore town.
Right.
For one thing, being inland, but two, just the nature of it. It was, you could actually go from Victorian mansions on Main Street, a couple blocks, and now you're in the farming country, mm-hmm. and barns and fruit, fruit trees and orchards and things like that. And so it's just very, very unique compared to a typical shore town.
And the history of it with the Revolution. We all hear Philadelphia, and we all hear, all these, but little area, the whole surrounding area, the British ships lay off in the Raritan Bay because, of course, the bay gave them some security from storms and such. And then you've got Fox Hill up there, which is a high point, which is famous for Captain Kidd's lookout, the trees.
Right.
And then during the Revolutionary War, the both sides, the Loyalists
exactly.
and the Patriots, both had lookouts going up there watching the ships in the bay. And then you had Burroughs, John Burroughs, son, who was an officer under Washington, and his wife is mortally wounded, even though it took a long time to kill her, because the Skinner Greens found out he was home visiting his new bride, and while he was getting out the back window to swim across Matawan Creek, she stalled them in the front door. And ended up getting, the history of this area. Yeah, the history.
It's something right out of the movies, and it actually happened in history.
Yeah, and the house is still there, people. Go visit it. The house is still there. You can go in there, and the stairs, this girl, what was she, 18?
18 years old, yes.
And she looks at them and says, "You're not getting anything, my shawl or anything," to a bunch of men who have come to either capture or kill her husband.
She was a fiery patriot.
Right.
She really had guts.
Yeah. The house is still there. Yeah. And there was they ended up, he got away. She was mortally wounded. They burned all their furniture on the front lawn. The history of this town.
They actually tried to burn the house down, too.
Yeah. This is the history of this place is incredible.
A lot of people don't realize that back during the American Revolution, it was very much like a civil war in New Jersey.
Yeah.
Because depending on what part of New Jersey you lived in, some areas were dominated by the Patriot cause and other areas by Loyalists. And in fact, most people have heard of the Battle of Monmouth, and they hear about, you know, Washington crossing the Delaware and the Battle of Trenton, and they think, well, what something happened during the American Revolution. They don't understand that there were actually over 100 engagements in New Jersey during the mm-hmm. American Revolution. They all weren't major battles, but they were patriots fighting Loyalists. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the British occupied Sandy Hook up until the very end of the Revolutionary War, and they were raiding, you know, different areas in Monmouth County. So when it seemed like the war was coming to an end in other parts of the colonies, in New Jersey, it was still active almost up until the end.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, the feelings ran very, very high in New Jersey as to whether you were a patriot or a loyalist. And I always tell whenever I do a tour of the Burroughs Mansion, I'm a former Army officer, and I can say this very openly, all wars are bad. There's never
yes.
been a good war.
No.
But civil wars are especially bad. Because now you have family members fighting each other, people who knew each other, people who went to the same church are now shooting at each other.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what it was like in New Jersey during the American Revolution.
Yeah, it just like anything else, you have people who are saying, okay, right now things are pretty good. If we stay friends with the British, things will keep going status quo. And then you have other people saying, but things could be so much better, you know. And these people are in your own family.
Exactly.
It could be your brother. It could be your father and son. Families were torn apart. It was Philip Freno lived in Matawan area, or it was Middletown
yes.
Point at that point. And he's known as the poet of the Revolution.
That's right.
Very.
He was actually married to, in fact, Margaret Foreman. It was John Burroughs' wife. Her sister, one of her sisters, was married to Philip Freno. So even the Burroughs were kind of connected to Philip Freneau, you know, through marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people today, they don't quite understand. You know, they say, I would have been a patriot if I lived back in those days. I just know I would have. You have to understand what it meant to be a patriot in those days, that you were going up against, you know, the strongest superpowers of the day, the British Empire, mm-hmm. and the largest navy in the world. And if you lost, you would be considered a traitor. And
right.
they just wouldn't kiss and make up and, you know, have a peace treaty. I mean, they would hang you. So a lot of people, to be a patriot, in fact, Benjamin Franklin said this one time, you know, we all hang together, we all hang separately.
Yeah, gentlemen, we will either hang together or hang separately.
That's what it meant.
Yeah.
It was a really, really major thing to sign on to the Revolution.
Yeah,
and
it was
a
scary
of
time.
Nowadays just don't realize how significant it was back in those days.
No, and that's, I think, one of the biggest failures that we've done for our young people, because, you know, that old saying, freedom isn't free.
Right.
There's always someone ready to take it away from you. And you either have to have people willing to stand the line and say, no, you're not doing that, or you have to have, you are sheeple. You're people that just go with the status quo and hope.
That's right.
If you just keep your head down and don't look people in the eyes, okay, they won't kill us today, but you get slowly killed. And in a very real sense, our young people are oblivious to how fragile what we have is. It could be taken away from us. And I don't think we have the fortitude that our forefathers in this country did.
Well, it took a great deal of a commitment to side with the Patriots. And then as time went on, we were such a young country. And it was, even after we were granted our independence, it was very fragile as mm-hmm. to whether we could keep it. And we actually had to fight another war, the War of 1812.
Yeah.
It was kind of like the Second American Revolution, to keep our independence, because
right.
this, the fledgling little country, people thought it was going to fail, and that we didn't have the stuff, you know, to stand up to some of these bigger powers. And we really, really, back in those days, had to make an effort to hold on to our independence once we got it.
Yeah, the Grand Experiment, they called it.
Right.
Yeah. So this area is hugely historic and very, it's gone totally unnoticed, and it's a shame. Matawan, New Jersey, people, you've got to go visit it and see it and get a feel for it. Go see the Burroughs Mansion. And I mentioned Captain Kidd. Where this shark entered Matawan Creek, there was a tree, right?
Well, actually, two trees. There was one very tall tree at the mouth of Matawan Creek, and the other tall tree was on top of Fox Hill, which is now Rose Hill Cemetery. And it was very, very tall, and they were called Captain Kidd's Rangers. So when Captain Kidd buried treasure, you know, along the coast, he used those two landmarks to visualize where the area was where he had buried his treasure. And for years, you know, people could see them from, a significant distance away.
Mm-hmm. And to this day, people believe that there is treasure buried off the coast of New Jersey in this area.
Could be.
Could be. I don't think so, but it could be.
It's one of those things that they did. Captain Kidd was in this area, and he operated out of New York, and he was through this area. And especially, some of the pirates and people who were privateers and pirates came into these, you know, inland waterways when they were, you know, burying their treasure to hide it till they could, you know, access it again. And whether, you know, someone is going to be fortunate enough someday to actually dig up something in their garden, that's something else. But the possibility of something like that happening, knowing the history of the area, and knowing that that there were ships in the area and people were unloading different things in that area, it is a possibility, and that makes for a great adventure. But we'll see if anyone really lucks out.
So now we come forward, and now we're in 1916. And I imagine maybe the barber shop had a phone, and
That's
certain
right.
stores had phones. And there has been a shark attack down in another part of New Jersey, which I'm pretty sure probably made one of the newspapers, right?
Well, there are two shark attacks. There was one shark attack in Beach Haven on July 1st. You know, a young man by the name of Charles Van Zandt was attacked by a shark and had major wounds, leg wounds, and he died as a result of the wounds the same day. A few days later, on July 6th, there was another shark attack in Spring Lake in front of the Essex and Sussex Hotel. The bell captain of the hotel, his name was Charles Bruder, was attacked while taking an afternoon swim. And the shark at that time actually bit off his two legs below the knees, and he died immediately in the water.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was, a major event. This happened a few days before the Matawan shark attack. So all of these things, you know, happened within 12 days. Then on July 12th, there were actually three shark attacks in Matawan on the same day, where three people were attacked. Two of the three died. And the third person, a young boy, 12 years old, Joseph Dunn, survived the shark attack. He had severe wounds, and he was in the hospital, you know, for several months from his wounds.
Mm-hmm.
So this was really something.
Yeah,
back in those days.
But here's the thing that, again, people today do not understand. There weren't hospitals in every town.
That's right.
There were main hospitals. There was one in South Amboy, I believe, or Perth Amboy.
Well, there's one in East Brunswick, St. Peter's Hospital.
Right.
And then there was Monmouth Medical Hospital, Monmouth Medical down in Long Branch. They
right.
were the two major hospitals, you know, serving this particular area. But one of the major problems they had back in those days, the roads weren't paved. So, you know, even if the hospital, you know, might only be, you know, 10, 12 miles away, going over a bumpy road in an open car could be a fatal experience for someone who happened to be severely wounded. Mm-hmm. And there was one advantage with the Matawan shark attack with Stanley Fisher. They took him down to Monmouth Memorial Hospital because the actual shark attack took place a short distance from Matawan train station. Mm-hmm. And Matawan was connected by the New York Long Branch Railroad directly with Long Branch, so they were able to put Stanley Fisher on a train and take him down to that particular hospital by train, and he actually took the 506 train, and it arrived in Long Branch at 5:30, and he died an hour after that. It's amazing actually that he survived as long as he did.
Yeah.
Because he had horrendous wound. It took 10 pounds of flesh off his leg. It was completely denuded. The artery was severed. A major, major loss of blood. And just the shock end of it. And he was conscious almost till the very end. And was speaking to the attending surgeon until just a few moments before he died. And that almost seems like a miracle that he lasted that long. But
right.
Stanley Fisher was a very healthy man. He was a big man. He was about 6 foot one, 210 pounds. He was one of the strongest men in Matawan,
mm-hmm.
Physically. A great athlete, very popular with everyone, belonged to several organizations, was a wonderful singer, had a beautiful voice. And everybody, in my book, I call him a favorite son of the town. Everybody, you know, felt a connection to Stanley Fisher.
Mm-hmm.
You know, young and old. The kids admired him because, you know, he was like a hero. He was like an athletic hero. The older people admired him because he was so talented, and he really was a friendly man. He was caring and concerned about everybody in town. And when he died, it was like, you know, taking a severe blow to the gut to the town to have to, you know, handle this death because it was such a significant guy, such a great guy. And
mm-hmm.
to die in that way was, you know, so shocking to the people.
Did I lose you?
No.
Oh.
No, it's just that it was a shock that I always mention, you know, when I talk to people in my historical talks that dying young back in those days was not unusual.
No.
In fact, if you go out to Rose Hill Cemetery and look at some of the tombstones, you see a number of people, you know, died as teenagers, if they made it to teenagehood. And a lot of people died young, in their 20s. So dying young wasn't that unusual. But the fact that you're one of the healthiest people in town, like the town hero, and then you're killed in a shark attack, that's the thing that was just hard for everyone to comprehend. It's like something has happened in this town that no one could anticipate, and no one understands why. It's just, something like that happening on an inland waterway.
Yeah.
Where you're expecting to be able to splash around in the water. The kids were actually skinny dipping, the boys, who were attacked at first. And the Matawan Creek was a secure place for a lot of people. They figured that this, in fact, I mentioned in the book, the Matawan Creek winds through the town almost like a snake. And everybody has, all sort of people who live in town had sentimental stories about growing up along Matawan Creek. They called it the Crick. And it had such a special meaning for them. And then to have something like this happen in almost the center of their town was just a little bit too much for people to process back in those days.
You were talking about it wasn't unusual for young people to pass away because of this, young. The Spanish flu was taking young people left and
very
right.
Much so.
The huge, my mother's cousins and stuff that had gotten here, they ended up being raised by other relatives because their parents died in the flu influenza. And up in Rose Hill, there's a section for right. people that died from the flu. So you're right.
Back 65 in this small village, if you can imagine, the 65 people died from you know, the fall of 1918 to the spring of 1919. When Spanish flu hit the United States, there were 675,000 people in the United States died from the Spanish influenza. Mm-hmm. They estimate anywhere from 50 to 100 million people died worldwide of the Spanish influenza. Mm-hmm. And it was a virus, and it attacked, and it was a very horrible way to die. And in fact, they would actually drown from the fluids in their lungs. It was a really, really, you know, ghastly mm-hmm. type of death. And the amazing thing is, a cure was never found for it. It came on its own, and it left on its own. We never conquered it. Like people today, they think, well, there's an illness. You know, doctors or scientists, they'll figure out a way. They didn't. Back in 1918, we basically took it. And when it decided to leave, it left.
Yeah, it had to run its course.
Don't understand how bad that thing was. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, and right now in, I think, northern Jersey is a chickenpox epidemic. And it's from people who don't want their children to get vaccinated. And they says, well, what can the chickenpox do to you? Well, besides making you blind, sterile, you end up with shingles later on in life, which are very painful. There's a lot of things it can do. But then you have the argument, but if we don't have these diseases, how do we build up defenses to them?
That's right.
And so you look at it and say, is it a blessing or a curse that we've learned now we have different antibiotics and we have different things to combat these diseases with, but on the other hand, now we're even more vulnerable because we can't fight off that, you know? We've kind of screwed ourselves in a little bit, right?
Is, you know, antibiotics only work on bacteria.
Right.
They don't work on viruses.
On viruses.
And the Spanish influenza was a virus. Mm-hmm. So even if it came today, it's not a case, well, this is 2016 and things are different now. We have all sorts of medicines. Not necessarily. If it's a virus, there are things that will, you know, treat the different symptoms and things like that. But there are the people like down at the Disease Control Center are very, very concerned whenever, you know, a major virus, you know, hits the world, because mm-hmm. it could be something like the Spanish influenza, maybe not quite as dramatic. We've got hospitals, we've got better ways to transport people, different ways to deal with the symptoms. But they get very, very nervous when they think of the possibility of another pandemic like they had in 1918.
Let's talk about another part of, and this is every town, this is all over the world. Back in 1916, infant mortality rates, childbirth. You know, you look back and see in some of the old cemeteries, you look at a man's, cemetery marker, his tombstone, and it'll say his name, and then he might have as many as four wives. And you sit right. there and say, wow, what a rogue. No, women died in childbirth back
right.
then. And they died of different things, and having a child just depletes your body of everything. So the chances of a woman who maybe had an underlying illness and didn't even know it, now she gets pregnant, she has this child, and she doesn't survive, or the baby doesn't survive, or they both don't survive. So when you have a young man who's 23 years old, athletic, he's the town boy, he's everybody's idea of what the American, all-American kid should be, and they say, well, he's dead, and they say, well, what of? And they say, a shark got him in Matawan Creek. That's where the shock factor came in.
Well, one thing that I bring out in my book, which is kind of ironic in the whole situation, Stanley Fisher was like a local hero. Everything he did, it's like he touched gold. I mean, he was a good singer, he was a good athlete, mm-hmm. he was a good-looking guy. Everything going for him. And, in fact, his father was a well-known sea captain, Captain Watson H. Fisher. He was actually the commodore of the Savannah Steamship Line. And Stanley had traveled with his father a number of different times, you know, in the summers on the ship down to Savannah. And he'd watched his father, who was a sea captain, and a lot of people in town thought maybe he'd follow in his father's footsteps and become, you know, go to sea. His father went to sea as a cabin boy and eventually went all the way up the line to become the commodore of the steamship company. And the strange thing was he decided that he's not going to go to sea like his father. The family was very, you know, Stanley, you do what you think you want to do. He decided to stay on land and develop a career. He was very successful, good, you know, dealing with people and mm-hmm. a great communicator. And after he decided to stay on land and have a land career with his more regular hours where you go home every night instead of being on a ship traveling from place to place, yeah. and then he dies in a shark attack. It's like a complete reversal of the way you think the story should, you know, end up. Mm-hmm. You know, after deciding not to go to sea and to stay and have a career on land, he dies of a shark attack. And that's what a lot of people were kind of just amazed by the whole
thing. Yeah, the whole day started with Captain Cottrell walking over that little bridge over Matawan Creek that we've driven over a million times. And he's walking over there, and he sees a large fish moving up the stream.
Yeah,
now, he had to get to a phone because, like I said, you didn't have cell phones. You didn't have any of those luxuries. So where did he go to get this phone to warn the sheriff?
He went to the gatekeeper of the bridge. There was a gatekeeper's shack at the end of the bridge. He went to the gatekeeper's shack. He actually called the Matawan town marshal. Matawan had only two policemen back in those days. They didn't have a real police department. The town marshal, his name was John Molsoff, was also the town barber. The assistant marshal, his name was Bart Tice, he was a baker, you know, mm-hmm. during his regular working life. So these were people who were, yeah, kind of, but the irony is these two policemen were tough guys. They were both big men, and you know, they often, I often kind of think of, you know, Marshall Dillon back in the Gunsmoke days. That this wasn't exactly Matawan back in those days, but considering, you know, some of the brawls they would have on a Saturday night at some of the bars in town, you had to be a tough guy to be a lawman back in those days. So when we say he was a town barber, that doesn't mean that he also carried, people would say he carried a blackjack in his back pocket. And he, on occasion, he would bring a gun with him, but he didn't always carry a gun. But people would see him coming with that blackjack in his back pocket. And if he told you to do something, you wouldn't think twice about doing it. I mean, he was an imposing type guy, but he had a telephone in his barber shop. So the call went from the gatekeeper's or the bridge keeper's little shack to the town marshal's office, which was his barber shop, and basically said that there's a shark coming up Matawan Creek. It's headed in your direction. It's about 8 feet long, and you better watch out.
Mm-hmm. So he gets this thing, he calls it in, and nobody believes it at first. And then they see naked boys running through town screaming. This is where I'm looking at it, like as if I was sweeping my steps or stoop in one of the houses there, you know, and all of a sudden you see these naked boys running past screaming bloody blue murder. And the only one who pays any attention to them really is Stanley Fisher. And in the back of his head, he's thinking the Stillwell boy is an epileptic, right?
Right. Exactly.
So he's not...
Something was wrong.
Wrong.
It was dreadfully wrong. He wasn't so sure about the shark business, but something was wrong. In fact, they used to call it back in those days when Lester would have a fit, they would call it the shakes.
Right.
And he would experience the shakes and go into a seizure. And what Stanley was afraid of, if that happened in the water, where people might, you know, kind of contain it on the ground, if it happens in the water, it could be a fatal experience. And that's what he knew when the boys were up there, naked, screaming that something had happened to Lester. He took them seriously. This wasn't just a prank. This was something very, very serious.
Yeah, because running through town buck naked, even in 1916, was enough to get your rear end behind a woodshed.
Sure, exactly.
You know, that was the way it was, you know. What are you doing?
These boys were terrified.
Right.
They weren't laughing or joking. They were frightened to death almost by what had happened to them. And that's what the people try to process. What's going on here?
While he's headed towards the stream, Captain Cottrell, he was in like a boat of some kind trying to go up the stream to track this thing?
Yes. Well, he actually came in by boat from the gatekeeper's shack on the bridge. Mm-hmm. It's about almost a mile and a half, so it's not just right around the corner. And he came by a small motorboat and then... Left his motorboat along the side of the creek, and then ran up to Main Street's not far at all from Matawan Creek. Matawan Creek is just behind Main Street, and then he was going in town. But in fact, one of the strange ironies of this whole situation, Captain Cottrell had gone past the Wyckoff Dock. It's like as fate would have it, before the boys came down for their swim. So the boys had no idea that he had seen a shark. He was, you know, talking to people uptown, and they weren't believing him. And by the same time, you know, the shark was attacking Lester. And it's just one of those strange, you know, twists of fate that if he'd been a little bit slower, maybe he could have warned the boys, and there wouldn't have been a shark attack. And maybe Lester would have lived, and Stanley would have lived. But just the fact that he missed them by so many minutes, that there was a shark attack where two people died.
Why write this book? I mean, everybody knows that, anybody with any common sense knows that the book Jaws, the movie, is based on this story. There's just no way you can have that many hits on things that happen. The boy swimming, the guy, you know, hey, you guys okay? You guys okay? You know, the whole thing. What was it? Did you have to set the record straight?
I wanted to fill in the gaps that the other books, the other movies, didn't talk about. No one talked about Stanley Fisher, his private life, his early life, what it was like. This young man, who is like a hero to everybody, dies in the prime of life, and that sounds bad, but no one knows about this guy.
Right.
And what I decided to, in my book, was to take from the time Stanley Fisher was born. I follow him all the way through going through school, you know, with the different parties he went to. In fact, the Matawan Journal back in those, it was a newspaper that would tell you everything. It was 8 pages long. And if someone had a tea party or someone, a firehouse had a social or somebody had a picnic, they would tell you in depth every single thing that went on. And what I did was to follow his life from the time he was born up until he died at age 24 to fill in the gap so people could know what this man was like his whole life. It's really a biography of Stanley Fisher, this hero. And it's also a biography of the town because Stanley Fisher, to really understand him, as I point out in the book, you have to understand where he grew up, the place he lived, the people who surrounded him. His interaction with people. That's something that wasn't dealt with in other books. So if you've read the other books, if you read my book, it's going to be something extra that you haven't heard before.
Yeah.
That's the reason I wrote this book.
You're talking about the ethics of the people, the kind of people they were. If a child went missing, everybody went looking for that child. Not today so much. Yeah, you have people who do this, but a lot of people don't want to get involved. Back then, if somebody in town had something wrong, Mrs. Jones, she had that baby, she's not doing well. The local women would make pot dishes, and they would take turns. The church, you would have church the women's group would say, okay, I'm making dinner for the Monday. Who's doing Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday? And they would keep this up as long as it took to get the family back on their feet, you know? It was a different time then. People weren't distracted by TV and all the other things that go on.
That was very special that I bring out of the book that is not necessarily copied today is the fact that back in Matawan, you had large houses, you had Victorian mansions, you had wealthy people, and you had people who were dirt poor, and you had people in the middle. And what was amazing back in those days was the interaction between this class system. I mean, they took care of each other. I mean, you could have someone living right next to a mansion who lived in a normal, regular house that went to work every day. And they would see each other when they were going out. They would say, hello, Mr. So-and-so, hello, Mr. So, both ways. People cared about each other. Mm-hmm. And, in fact, what's interesting, Stanley Fisher came from one of the most prominent, wealthiest families in town. Lester Stillwell, who is the boy he lost his life to recover the body, was one of the poorest boys in town. Mm-hmm. So you've got this you know, economic background didn't mean anything. These people cared about each other. Didn't matter whether you were wealthy or which church you went to. You were part of the town, and everybody had that. You were like family. The whole town was like a family, mm-hmm. and that's something that a lot of people today, you know, find it kind of difficult to process because it was very different back in those days. They needed each other.
Yeah, you would sit out on a nice evening, and you would sit outside. And people would go for a walk, and you'd say, hello, you know, how are you this evening? How's your, you know, today you're almost afraid to look at anybody. You know, you're afraid to raise your eyes to look at anybody. When I go to, like, stores and stuff, well, you know me. I'm crazy. Mm-hmm. I'm a crazy booger. So, you know, I look at anybody and say, hi, how are you doing today? And they look at me like I just called them a filthy name. You know, what? You're talking to me? Really? You know, well, what did you think? You were dead? Nobody could see you? You're alive? You're standing there? Yes, I said, hello. How are you? You know?
What's interesting, Mo, is that there's something that hasn't changed. I bring out my book that, you know, yes, our lifestyle, we've got the internet, we've got talk radio, we've got all these things, and that's a little bit different from back 1916. But there is something that's in people today that happened to be in Stanley Fisher. When he saw something tragic happen, he had to do something. He couldn't. In my book, I use this expression, look the other way. He couldn't look the other way. He had to do something. There are people today, sometimes all of a sudden they're driving down the road and they see a car on fire and they pull over. And you've got people who, average everyday people, not professional rescuers, firemen or policemen, that will risk their lives for a complete stranger. It still happens. There's something in people that, whether it was 1916 or 2016, that there are certain people feel they have to do something. And thank God, that hasn't changed. There's still people like that today.
Well, now you also have people that take a phone and start recording the whole thing.
Exactly.
They'll watch the car burn. They'll watch everybody listen to them screaming. And they take videos and post them. You know, and I look and say, you know, are you an imbecile? You know, do something. Help me.
I know. There's still back in those days. I mean, you study history. That's what I do. I go way back in time. Certain things you see today happened 500 years ago. I mean, people weren't that different back. There have always been evil, selfish people who looked out for themselves, who've been greedy. There have also been very dedicated, good people throughout history who have done certain things. So that's it's always been a mix.
Yeah.
But I think one thing that I think is going to be important, that as we go into this new world of possible local terrorism, and, you know, someone is going to, you know, set off a bomb in your town, or someone is going to all of a sudden become a sniper in your neighborhood. You know, what's going on in the world comes to you very quickly. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people are wondering, what would I do if I were put in one of those life and death situations where someone is shooting at me, or someone is shooting at my family, or shooting at my friends? What would I do? Mm-hmm. And when you read about someone like Stanley Fisher, where he basically gave his life to try to, for a value that he had. And like I said, people today would say, I'm not a hero. You know, there are heroes, but I'm not.
Yeah, I'm not a hero.
And you wonder what would happen if all of a sudden you're put in that situation, and now you're going to have to become a hero. If you want to save your life or you want to save your family, you're going to have to do it. And people sometimes nowadays are starting to think, you know, this isn't the Wild West anymore, but what would I do if I had to stand up and do that?
How much are you willing to give up? How much are you willing to take before you finally say, okay, enough? You know, are you willing to watch somebody? One of these things that's going on now is these sucker punches and people with knives. They go and people know who these people are.
Right.
And they're not saying anything. To me, they're just as guilty as the people doing it. And don't hand me this crap, you're afraid of them. You call the police and say, look, this is who's doing it, and let them pick them up, you know? Because eventually,
it's very dangerous nowadays to have that attitude, I'm going to look the other way. I don't want to get involved.
Yeah.
If everybody takes that attitude, we're all at risk. And the likelihood of you being involved, whether you want to or not, increases. If people do start to, if there's something, you know, we get some magical spell we could put over the country. Now people care about each other, or at least they try to think about their neighbors, and they try to look out for each other. If that happens, there might be hope for us, because now maybe we will be the way people were back in 1916. Where they
maybe
out,
your
they
book
cared
will
about each
inspire
other.
It. Maybe
when
people read
kid,
this.
I grew up in Western Pennsylvania. In an ethnic neighborhood, and when I was 4 years old, I was walking around the neighborhood on my own, and I lived in a town in Western Pennsylvania. It wasn't actually a village; 50,000 people lived there, so it wasn't a tiny village. Mm-hmm. But people looked out for each other, and I mean, I would be walking around, and everybody knew me. Everybody knew my mother, and everybody was watching out for me. The whole area was watching out for me.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine today if you had a four-year-old and you sent a four-year-old out in the neighborhood walking around on his own? My mother would tell me, come home when I call for you, you know, on the back porch. And I'd say, oh, sure, Mom. But people blow their mind to think about doing that today. But the world was like that at one time.
Remember, I try to put on movies so Teddy will... Something that Teddy can gravitate to, okay? And the other day, I put on The Untouchables, Kevin, whatever his name, Costner. And the reason is, when the little girl goes in to buy the bucket of beer, now we look and go, oh my God, they sent this child to buy a bucket of beer? And Teddy said, I used to do that.
Yeah.
That was the norm.
And I both did that when we were kids.
Yeah,
that's
we
the
all
world
did
was
it.
Then.
Yeah, you know, it was go to the corner and buy a bucket of beer, okay? And you went and you did it, and you brought it back to your parents, and God, you had all the change there. You never stole the change or anything. It was a different world then. People weren't afraid of somebody coming along and taking your kid on you. You know,
I still remember
everybody
going to a candy store when I had a nickel, and I would stand in front of the counter, and I'd point to this, give me two of those, give me one of those for a nickel.
Yeah.
And then I'd have a little bag that I would take home with me with candy in it.
In the movie, the bartender, the owner of the pub there, says, how's your mommy? She's not
That's
feeling
right.
good. She's got a headache. He knows this child. Like Teddy said, they used to go in the back room and wait in the back door, and they'd come and say, what do you need? Oh, mommy needs this filled, and okay, and they might sneak him a piece of candy and say, okay, take this to mommy, you know, or da, or whoever it was, and they weren't bad parents. This was the way it was.
It was a different world.
I kind of try to say, don't judge history by your standards. They
exactly.
weren't the standards of the day. And your book...
That's the first rule for a historian, is you've got to put yourself in the context of the time.
You
can't evaluate things based on, you know, what it's like in 2016. You've got to go back in time, and you've got to read about that period. You read as much as you can. Then you look at what people did, and now you can understand that they were in a different time, and their way of evaluating things, their way of making decisions was very different than how we view things in 2016.
One of the things that upsets me terribly is today slavery and owning human beings is wrong. That's today, 2016. After the Emancipation Proclamation, it became a bad thing, okay? But when slaves were first brought to this country, and the first slave was an Irish person, by the way, just in case any of our listeners doesn't know that, they were sold to these people by their own, their own tribe leaders. Mm-hmm. And everybody says, oh, it was horrible and we shouldn't talk about it. But if you don't talk about it, it's going to happen again. We don't have the same kind of slavery. Now we have sex slaves because everybody puts their heads in the sand. Sex slaves has become a huge industry. Back in the 1500s, the 1600s, it was called commerce. And if you get a hold of one of these bastards trading human beings as sex slaves, they'll tell you it's just business. Exactly. There's a demand, and there's supply and demand.
When you study history, you can't totally divorce yourself of your upbringing and your background, and you don't really have to. But
no.
You have to understand that when you're evaluating someone else, and you have to kind of look at how they viewed things at the time. I'm not saying we ever put a happy face on slavery.
No.
We put a happy face on evil. But at the same time, and you don't necessarily excuse them, because many people back then, they were torn. They were religious. A lot of people were very religious. Even people who owned slaves were religious.
Yeah.
And it wasn't just a put-on. But they processed, they viewed things differently. And you can almost talk yourself into anything.
Mm-hmm.
Even a good person, you know, can you know, rationalize doing all sorts of things that are evil. And that's really what would kind of happen. You know, the churches backed up what they were doing in slavery. The laws, you assume that a law is something good, and that to follow a law is a good person. I remember when I was in high school, our high school band went on a trip. We went to Florida, and we actually traveled in the early 1960s through these different states where they had segregation.
Yeah.
And I actually saw firsthand what it's like when certain people are not allowed to eat in the same room.
Mm-hmm.
And this one restaurant we were in, the manager came over and was saying, you know, you people, you're from the North. You don't understand this. But if I do what you would like me to do, I will be arrested. I will be breaking the law. And that's what you almost have to analyze and to put yourself in the context of those things at that time, and to understand how a lot of these people, you know, were kind of talked themselves into things. And there were other people who had to fight that, and the civil rights move and everything that came as a result of it. It wasn't easy. And that's why when you look at it from a point of view of history, you realize how remarkable that is and what courage it took to stand up against society when everybody else is going along with something and you're the one that's different. A lot of people want to be part of the herd. They want to be part of the group.
Yeah.
And when you see something wrong, it takes a lot of courage to stand up and say, I'm not going to do it, and I'm not going to let you do it. I'm going to work against that.
And right.
That's what a lot of these people did.
When I was in Atlanta, Georgia, and it was 1970, and I went into a Macy's in Atlanta, Georgia, and I was asking this girl who was a black girl for help, and she says, don't talk to me. She says, you don't understand. You'll get me fired. And this white man came over and said, Miss, is this woman bothering you? And he meant the girl that worked there, the black girl. And he's asking me, is she bothering me? And I says, no. I asked her a question. And he kind of shrugged his head and she ran. And it was like, oh my God, I can't believe I just witnessed this.
No,
you know?
It's like from a different world.
It is. It's culture shock. And I look back at it and I always think how horrible that was. And she understood I was trying to be kind and I was inquiring about something. And I just stepped into it because I was ignorant. And I didn't understand the way it worked down there, you know? And history we need to remember history just so we can see how we got to this point. How we got to this point. Your book is about 1916 Matawan, a hero who's never gotten his full amount of recognition. You've written a book. You're going to have a book signing. When is that?
Yes. I'll be doing a book signing down at Barnes & Noble in the Eatontown Mall on June 30th from 6:30 to 8:30.
Okay.
I look forward to seeing anyone who'd like to come down. And I'll be doing a little talk on the shark attack, too, but I'll look forward to meeting people who are interested in this topic.
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to be there, and you're going to sign the damn book on me, and I'm going to hide it so Teddy doesn't shred it. I'm going to have to hide it. I'm going to put it in under a lock and key someplace so he doesn't shred it. If people want to buy it, where can they get it other than at there?
Okay. I just want to point out one thing. I'm donating 100% of all anything that comes profit this to the Matawan Historical Society. I did this book as an act of love for history, and it's not to make any money myself. So anyone, if you buy the book, the money will be used to further history in the area and to protect different things that we should hold on to before we lose them. But the book is being sold by the Matawan Historical Society, and like I said, all the proceeds will go to, you know, furthering local history. And if you there's one website we have that if you want to contact us, we're in the process of, you know, the book is coming out, so some of these things are still happening. But if you contact us at matawanhistorical@gmail.com, we will be happy to to get a book to you.
Well, I'm gonna post it. I'm going to get it off of Kathy because she's my cohort, and I'll get all the information and post it on Facebook and everything. I want to talk about the other things that you are Matawan's historian. And we want to talk about that, but I have a couple of clips that I want to play. And guess what, guys? There's no commercials tonight. So these clips are from the movie, which they kind of tickle me. So we've got about 3 minutes of little clips that I'm going to take you through. And then Al and I are going to talk about other historical parts and about where the victims of these shark attacks are buried, which is also part of Matawan history. And you're listening to the last Mo Banshee's Lair on Dreamstream Radio. But you haven't heard the last of me, you poor things. So so we'll be right back.
I think that I am familiar with the fact that you are going to ignore this particular problem until it swims up and bites you on the ass.
Agree to that.
Only 24 hours.
24 hours is like 3 weeks.
You all know me. Know how I earn a living. I'll catch this bird for you, but it ain't gonna be easy. Bad fish. Not like going down the pond chasing bluegills or tommy cods. This shark, swallow you whole. Shaking, tenderizing, down you go. We gotta do it quick. I don't bring back the tourists. I'll put all your businesses on a paying basis. But it's not going to be pleasant. I value my neck a lot more than $3,000, Chief. Fine him for $3,000, but I'll catch him and kill him for $10,000. You got to make up your minds. Going to stay alive and ante up? Want to play it cheap? be on welfare the whole winter. I don't want no volunteers. I don't want no mates. There's too many captains on this island. $10,000 for me by myself. For that, you get the head, the tail, the whole damn thing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Quint. We'll take it under advisement.
Mr. Mayor, Chief, ladies and gentlemen. Farewell and adieu to you fair Spanish ladies.
Here's to swimming with bow-legged women.
You heard him, slow ahead.
Slow ahead. I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chum some of this shit.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
And that was some clips from the movie Jaws, which is based on this story. There's no way. The author says, Benchley says, no, he never heard of the story, and I don't buy it, but that's my personal opinion.
No one buys that because
nobody buys it.
The references, you know, in the book and in the movie to what happened, I don't think he... I think maybe the New York Times, that one article said, it is the inspiration. It is certainly, if it is not the, it is one of the inspirations. Everyone buys into that. And
yeah.
Even Peter Benchley does, too. So it's,
yeah.
Some of these people are funny about their little things.
Yeah. I just happened to dream up the exact same scenario, you know? The boys in this thing and the guy, are you guys okay? And he gets the leg taken off. I mean, yeah. Okay. The thing about this book that you're bringing out is it's bringing attention to a man who people were yelling at him. Don't go in the water, don't go in the water, because the shark might still be there. But he felt that this kid's parents needed at least a body. I mean, the worst nightmare for a parent is not knowing. Are they dead? Where are they? What happened to them? Are they still alive? What happened?
Back in those days, this is one thing that's very different today. Because, you know, they'll distinguish between a rescue operation and a recovery operation. A rescue means they're going to save someone's life, and they take all sorts of risk. A recovery operation is they know that someone is dead, and they're going to be recovering a body. And, you know, they're not going to take, they don't want to lose more people, so they won't take, you know, extra chances. But that distinction between rescue and recovery was not so clear back in those days. The one thing that was very, very important to a family, as I mentioned earlier, that people dying young wasn't so unusual, but it was very, very important for these families to have a body, so that you could have the body, you could have a funeral, you could have your religious rites, and you could have a burial, you could go to the grave and put flowers on the grave, and that was very, very important to those people, very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
Can't stress enough. And what they were, these men who were risking their lives, were Stanley Fisher, George Burlew and Arthur Smith, they were doing the same thing Stanley was. They were diving down into the shark-infested water. They knew that every single time they went down, that it might be their last time, and they could die in a horrible, agonizing death. They did it anyway, because mm-hmm. that idea of, we want, it's very, very sad that this boy has died, but we want the family to have, you know, the body. And before the shark could take it away, drag it back out to Raritan Bay, if they could get the body for the family, they were willing to risk their lives to do that. That's something I think is really amazing. And I think people today should understand, you know, that these men knew what they were doing. They weren't reckless men. They all had families, loving families, and they were doing this as a conscious act because they felt it was important.
Mm-hmm. They call you the cemetery man.
That's one of my nicknames, yes.
Well, we have a lot of them, but we don't say them to your face.
Right.
No. Al is one of the most stand-up guys I've ever known, and he and his wife, Kathy, they're just a treasure. They're two very nice people. Everybody at the Matawan Historical Society are just great because it's not about egos. It's about, you know, keeping the history alive, making sure people understand how prominent Matawan is in Americans' history. It's you know, it's not big like Dodge City for all the murders, but it's big for the revolution. It's big for the commerce. It's big for the shark attacks. It's big for other things. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think I read that Robert E. Lee stopped in Matawan, didn't he?
Could be. You know,
yeah.
In fact, Robert, a lot of people don't understand this. When he was president of Washington Lee University, he traveled in the North, and he was very popular. I mean, after the Civil War, you know, a lot of people realized that what he did by basically ending the war and surrendering to Appomattox, this war could have gone on for years as a guerrilla war. And people respected him for saying that now things are over and we're gonna heal, we're gonna be one country again. Mm-hmm. And he had a lot to do with bringing the country, you know, together, and they respected him for it. So he was president of Washington Lee University, and he traveled in the North, and people were very happy to have him. And people from the North would send their children. I did. I said my son graduated from Washington Lee University in Lexington, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And back in those days, people from the North would send their children down there because they respected him as a very noble man and
mm-hmm.
Doing something for his. You know, he was an officer in the U.S. Army, and then he did what he felt he had to do for his state of Virginia. But then after this was over, he said, "Now let's pick up the pieces. Let's not continue. Let's come back together." And that's why he did travel in the North and was very received very well.
Something you just said stirred the little gray cells in the back of my head. I do still have some that work.
Good.
Here's the deal with war, gentle listeners. There are people who will not stop. And then you don't have men fighting anymore. You have 13-year-old children being dragged into this. Hitler
That's right.
did it. Japan did it. You know, and if somebody doesn't say, all right, this really sucks. This is possibly the worst thing I've ever done in my life, but I want you to drop a goddamn bomb and just stop it now. And then everybody goes, whoa, everybody stop. And yeah, it's horrible, and the aftermath for years is terrible, but it stops it. It stops children from being brought up into this, because the minute a kid was able to hold a damn rifle in war, an adult will say, here, kid, grab a rifle. You're in the army now. And unless you stop it, you do something monumental and just stop it, there are people who will keep going. There's people in the South who'll say the war's never ended for them. And all they've done is condemn their children to living this antiquated, warlike, unsociable lifestyle where they can't move forward. They're stuck.
They become fanatics. And
yeah, and they're stuck.
Everything. They no longer think.
Yeah. And so I'm one of the few people who said, I hate the atom bomb. And I understand what Einstein said, oh my God, you know. But it stopped the Japanese. It just, everybody said, whoa, we don't have one of them. Everybody stop. Because they were sending children into fight. Vietnam, the same thing. Children, 12-year-olds. And now you're looking at it, and I've had people tell me it's against the Quran for a child under the age of 13 to touch a weapon. Bullshit. My son was there. Okay? You always have a fanatic who's willing to hand a kid a gun or rig him with a bomb and say, go on, you're going to meet Allah. This is wonderful. Until you stop it, you know? And yeah, these people, they had to live with people spitting at them for the rest of their lives saying, you did this, you did that. But they stopped it. And that's the thing that people don't want to hear. Rose Hill, you're the cemetery man. Rose Hill, it plays in your book too, right?
Well, yes, I mentioned it because a number of people, you know, who were involved in the shark attack are buried out at Rose Hill, and it's very much part of the history of the town. And in fact, what we are doing this summer, we're doing a trolley tour of involving all the different stops that were involved in the 1916 shark attack, and the trolley tour ends up at Rose Hill Cemetery, and we go to the graves of these different people who were prominent during the shark. Captain Cottrell is out there, mm-hmm. Lester Stillwell, Stanley Fisher, and it's part of the town. And as a historian, you realize that a cemetery is a historic site, and that what I tried to do on my cemetery tours is research the history, and I'm very fortunate, and there's so much history in this little cemetery that's interesting, that I try to put it together, and if I can help young people get, interested in local history, and I call it the history bug. If the history bug bites you, you'll never be bored for the rest of your life.
For the rest of your life, yeah. Yeah, exactly. I brought my granddaughters on it, and what struck them was the boy's grave. People still leave toys,
right,
and things on his. And then
it's so sentimental. It's really heartrending.
I go there and I told them, I says, now look straight up that little hill up there. And they looked up. I says, the guy who tried to save him but recovered the body is up there, as if he's
That's
still
right.
looking over. And keeping an eye on him. Yeah. You know, I'm in death, he's still trying to keep an eye on him. It's a beautiful cemetery. It's the last of what they call a garden cemetery, right?
Right. The movement started in 1804 at Père Lachaise Cemetery in Paris, France, where they were trying to... Cemeteries used to be very gruesome places where, all these horrible sayings and, all these tombstones sticking up. And Père Lachaise, they tried to make it beautiful. They had winding roads and ponds and hills and things like that. And it just kind of changed the whole face of the way people viewed cemeteries and how they would, funerals and death. In fact, the word cemetery in Greek means sleeping place.
Right.
And when they started this movement, they tried to make it as beautiful as possible. Now you would see out in the cemetery, you see angels and cherubs and things like that, and harps and all sorts of things that represent something peaceful. Before that, they called them graveyards or churchyards. They were really mm-hmm. gruesome places. And it just kind of, it changed with this cemetery movement where they tried to, make it a little bit nicer. The idea that you're sleeping till the resurrection and you're waiting to be with your relatives and things like that. I put a happy face on the whole thing instead of you're in the ground and the worms are crawling through your skull and things like that. Put on some of those old, epitaphs and, New England tombstones.
It also, it gave people a place to walk because the town's main street, you got horses crapping and
right.
you got flies. So you're sitting there on a nice night and say, you want to go for a walk? Not
sure.
really. Not really.
They were like the first public parks.
Yeah.
Before they had public parks.
My first...
You want to commune with nature and walk around and have a little picnic and, see the birds and the squirrels run around and you go to the cemetery. You wouldn't get... In fact, Matawan, back in the early days, at the time of the shark attack, the roads, Main Street wasn't paved. In the summer,
right.
it was an absolute mess of mud and gook all over the place with horse droppings. And in the winter, it was very icy and dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, if you wanted to really to have a nice place to go to, it wouldn't be Main Street Matawan. It would be Rose Hill Cemetery. And same thing happened in New York City. In fact, one of the major tourist sites in the early days of New York was Greenwood Cemetery in Brooklyn.
Right.
Same thing in Boston. Mount Auburn Cemetery in Boston was a cemetery like this, where people would go, and if they wanted to see the sights in Boston or in New York, they'd go to the cemetery. This was before the Statue of Liberty and all the, you know, the tourist trappings that came with Manhattan. The early tourist sites were the cemeteries.
Mm-hmm. I'm going way back with the first Outlaws, and it was my first time going on a family trip with them, and we went out to Pennsylvania, and it was for a family reunion. So when I got back, my mom and my dad said, so what did you go to? I says, I went to a fucking graveyard, you know, we're Irish, you know, and they said, what? And I said, the family reunion was in a graveyard. I'm not kidding you. There was a pavilion in the middle of the graveyard, and there were gnats from the fresh graves, and the kids were playing frisbee over these things, and it was, again, like, what the heck, you know?
I remember, you know, Memorial Day. It used to be called Decoration Day before it became Memorial Day when I was a kid. And we had a family tradition, and not just my family. Everyone in town had this tradition. In the mornings, we'd go out to the cemeteries. Everybody went out to the cemeteries in town, and you would tend the graves, and you would organize, you would scrub the tombstones, you get everything looking nice. And then in the afternoon, we had an amusement park in my hometown of Western Pennsylvania. We would go to the amusement park in the afternoon, and then we'd have fireworks at night. And that was my idea of a decoration day before it became Memorial Day. And when I think back, it was just a wonderful time that... And everybody would have someone, you know, a cemetery they would go to, and they would care for the graves, and they would, it was part of the tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And you wouldn't do one without the other. You certainly would go to the cemetery, and then you'd go out and have some fun, you know, at the amusement park.
Down at the camper, it's in Wharton State Forest, and there's Mount Pleasant Church there and cemetery, and they have a Memorial Day early morning where they put the wreath, because they have a lot of veterans there. They actually have veterans from the Revolutionary War buried there. They died later on in life, but it shows that they were in the Revolutionary War and stuff.
Right.
And it's quite beautiful when you go and you see these beautiful red, white, and blue wreaths with flowers and stuff like that. And every veteran has a flag on their site, you know, on their grave, you know. And you can't forget what they've done, because the reason we're here and the reason we're able to spit on the flag or do whatever it is we do is because somebody was willing to fight for that right for us.
Exactly.
And Memorial Day is coming up, so I hope everybody's going to try to go to some kind of Memorial Day celebration. Now your town, because we only have a half hour left, and
sure,
I could spend 5 hours with you, and you know that I've done it. The town of Matawan is, because it's the 100th anniversary of the shark attacks, so the town of Matawan is having a big festival type thing, commemorative thing. Can you explain exactly what's going on?
Well, first of all, I want to make it very clear to everybody that it's a commemoration of a historical event. We're not celebrating anything.
Right.
Because there are people who died under tragic circumstances. What we are commemorating was the fact that, I mentioned this in my book, they were the people pulled together, and they looked out for each other before they had professional rescuers. And many people risked their lives. Not just Stanley Fisher. He died, but there are a lot of people who went in the water who could have died the same death. And there were people who extended themselves. That's what we're commemorating in this 100th anniversary, the courage of the town, how the whole town pulled like one for all and all for one, you know, to help each other out. That's the thing that we're commemorating. And as part of it, obviously, two people died. And we will be having on the actual date, in fact, the hour of the shark attack, on July 12th, we're going to have a ceremony out of Rose Hill Cemetery at the exact hour of the shark attack, the one Lester Stillwell. And we're going to have a wreath-laying ceremony at Lester's grave at the cemetery, and then we'll go up on top of the hill And because Stanley died after Lester, and a short while after that, we'll have another ceremony at the top of the hill at Stanley's grave, and we'll lay a wreath down there, and we'll say prayers, and we'll talk about, you know, what happened that day, and how, and the heroism that was shown by Stanley and others, and that's what we are commemorating on this 100th anniversary. So that'll be. But in addition to that, we're going to be doing things for the two weekends. The first weekend will be July 9th, all the way through the second weekend, which will be July 17th. And we'll be having, you know, people coming in doing programs about you know, marine life. We'll be doing trolley tours, traveling around the town, seeing the different locations during the shark attack. We'll be having different displays. The students in town are doing artwork concerning the shark attack, and a number of different things. I'll be doing a program in the evening of Saturday, July 16th, in the community center. And then the next day after that, we'll be dedicating a monument in Memorial Park to the two people from Matawan who died, Lester Stillwell and Stanley Fisher. And it's going to be a beautiful monument, gray granite monument, and it will be dedicating that on that particular day. And anyone who comes to Matawan will be able to go to Memorial Park and see this monument. And we're also doing self-guided tours, so that if you don't go on one of the trolley tours and you come to Matawan at a different time, you can take a self-guided tour. We'll have, you know, programs for you for that purpose. So our goal in this is to promote history. Mm-hmm. And something that happened that is worth remembering, we're going to try to hopefully, you know, create a tradition where people can, you know, learn about history and learn about, you know, this concept of togetherness and self-sacrifice in a nice setting. And that's what we're trying to do as the Matawan Historical Society is basically coordinating all of this. We're working with the town council. We're also working with the town of Aberdeen, which was very close. In fact, they used to call them the Matawans, Matawan Borough and Matawan Township.
Mm-hmm.
Now Matawan Township is called Aberdeen, but we're involving Aberdeen in this and all the surrounding area. So it's not just a Matawan-type thing. It's everyone can feel a special pride about what happened back in those days. And it's certainly, through the years, I've noticed I've traveled all around the United States and in Europe, all over the place, and often I'll go and I'm registering in a hotel, and I can be out on the West Coast and I write down Matawan, New Jersey, and someone will look up at me and say, "Oh, the shark attack in Matawan."
Right. Yeah.
Or I'll be in Europe, I'll be in London, or I'll be in another European capital, and they'll say, "Oh, the shark attack." So people mm-hmm. have heard about this all over the world. There have been a number of movies, in addition to Jaws. You know, several movies mm-hmm. been made about this, and books have been written about it.
The History Channel,
the Animal
Channel, Shark Week. I mean, there's been so much. The one thing that we have to remember is sharks are not bad things. A young woman was bit recently by a nurse shark, and they are what they are. They are the scavengers of the ocean. They have a place in the ecosystem. And shark finning should be illegal. And people who, if you go to some place that serves shark fin soup, please don't go there anymore. That's the only way this message gets through, because sharks clean up animals in the ocean that
They have their role.
And it's unfortunate, and I wish everything could live forever, and we right. wouldn't have to work, but that's not real life.
The one thing that a lot of people don't realize, there are very few people around the world who die from shark attacks.
Yes.
It's a very small number.
Yeah.
And in fact, my wife and I did some research on this for the fun of it, that there are more people in the United States die of dog bites.
Mm-hmm.
Than shark attacks. Many
yeah.
more people die of bee stings. 22 people in the United States die from cows.
Mm-hmm.
You don't think of a cow as being a predator, but people who work around cattle or things like that, people die of being around
more
cows.
More people die of being hit with a hammer in the head by spouses.
Well, yeah. In fact, throughout the world, Very few people are bitten by sharks or die.
Right.
But about 3,000 people a year die from hippopotamus attacks around the world. It's so, I mean, it's very unlikely that if you go swimming, you're going to die of a shark attack, or that you'll even be bitten by a shark.
Right.
Compared to, you know, other things that are, in fact, about 122 people die in deer-related incidents. A deer runs out in front of your car, and people die trying to avoid hitting a deer. So, I mean, all sorts of things that can happen to you that are a risk, that no one should be afraid of enjoying themselves. And no one should ever take it out on the shark or any any animal. You know, they're God's creation, too, and we have an obligation to look out for them. So
After
when you read about the shark attack, it doesn't mean that, quote, the shark, you know, as a being, is a villain. It's an animal doing what animals do.
Yeah.
And sometimes when animals interact with human behavior, you can have an incident where someone can get hurt.
Yeah. After Jaws came out, I remember that people were just running out and killing sharks. And I was so upset. And I said, you don't understand, they have a place in the
ocean.
Everything
in nature is part of the balance.
It has, it's a system. And when you eliminate a part of that, and let's go back to Europe when they started killing cats.
Exactly.
And then, of course, rats ran rampant, and the fleas from the rats bit
bubonic
people,
plague,
and
yeah.
bubonic plague. The cats have a place in the system, and everything has to stay in check, or else something goes wrong. And one of the biggest things that goes wrong in our ecosystem is people getting involved, you know, people sticking their noses in. And I see people, and I got to tell you, I'm Irish. That means I was raised on fish, you know, and lamb. That's just the way it was. And shark does not taste great. When people say, well, I only kill the shark because I eat it. Oh, you're full of shit. It tastes crappy. It tastes terrible. You know, it's got that yuck taste. You know, so don't tell me that. You're a moron that likes to go out and kill sharks. They have their place. So we are not saying that anybody should go out in their boat with their friends and kill sharks, because you're going to do more damage to the ecosystem than you understand. Every animal, every plant has its place.
The only animal that doesn't seem to have a place, that doesn't really know its place, is man.
Is man.
Because man is one of the few animals that knowingly kills for the sake of killing.
Yes.
And there's not a reason to survive or an eco-reason. It's and that's what man has to do, is to learn to control it, his or her impulses that we have as animals.
Zachary Schweitzer is saying in the chat, like bees, people are out there spraying pesticides on, oh, I don't want them on my plants. I don't. The bees pollinate plants. That's why you have plants. That's why you get more plants.
Exactly.
They pollinate food. We need bees. And I'm in a camper in the middle of a state forest, and I can go out in the morning and I can taste the sprays, like the garden sprays that people are spraying, and you open your mouth and it's like you get a mouthful of it, and I'll yell, we're in a state forest.
Right.
What the hell are you doing? And they'll say, my Johnny's allergic to bees. Well, then you shouldn't be in a state forest. And I have to tell you, and we talked about this last week. Last summer, a big storm went through. It was like a cyclone-type deal, and the blueberry farms are there. And it took out all the beehives. And, you know, the farmers, they rent the bees from beekeepers. They put them in there so that their blueberry plants get pollinized and all this. Well, you had millions of bees that didn't know where to go. I get up in the morning, I go out, and there is my hummingbird feeder. And it is swamped with honeybees. And I'm like, oh, boy. And I knew it was a bad storm, because that night I actually had Teddy in the kitchen of the camper, and I was ready to push him under the table because I was afraid
we were going to get knocked over, you know?
Yeah.
And so I'm not stupid. I went, I'll bet you those hives were damaged, and these guys are looking for food today. So it took about 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and I went out, and all these bees are swarming it, and I'm putting new food out, and I'm washing it each time. And I did not get bit once or stung. Bees don't bite, they sting. I did not get stung once. It's like, I don't know who you are, nice lady, but thanks for the food.
That's right, sure.
You know?
The goal is not to hurt you. It's their goal is to survive, to do what a honeybee wants needs to do, to pollinate, and their role in nature. And that's what people have to realize. Sometimes when our two worlds, you know, kind of rub together, you can have an instance where, you know, animals get confused or you're a little bit too close. In fact, we have a lake house up in Sussex County. And a lot of people, you know, will leave the garbage cans, you know, not secured properly.
Right.
And now black bears will come down and start, you know, going into your garbage cans. And you have to be very, very careful. You don't want to do that because by nature, these animals, you know, are afraid of humans. They don't want to interact with humans. They want to stay in the woods. But if you make it too convenient with them by providing your garbage, you know, in an unsecured way, now these two worlds come together. And sometimes, you know, if a black bear loses its fear of humans, it can be very dangerous.
Right.
Like any situation like that. And it's not necessarily, in this particular case, the fault of the black bear. It's with people being, you know, living in an area like that and not understanding that they have to control, you know, how they dispose of their garbage. So if everything is secured properly, you won't have that problem because the animals won't get into your garbage.
I have a nephew.
You just have to be careful.
Yeah, I have a nephew up in Hope, and he bought an old farm. It was like a farm, and it's got a lake, like a pond in the middle of it. Evidently, there has been a bear trail going through this for 1,000 years. And when he bought it, the people told him, look, there's a bear trail through our property. The bears come down in the morning, and they'll sit in the pond. Then they'll move on to the lake. And then around 7 o'clock at night, they'll bring the babies back. They'll let them play in the pond for a little bit, and then they move. All you got to do is lock the animals up, make sure your garbage is locked up, and they'll move. And he's been there, I guess, for 15 years now and had never had a problem. You know, he's got horses. He's got, you know, different animals. He just makes sure he's got them locked up, you know.
It was kind of funny. One situation, my neighbor told me there was a black bear on my porch trying my door to see if I had anything in the kitchen.
Yeah.
He actually took a picture of that black bear on my porch.
Yeah, my son's looking at it.
I try to secure everything, but sometimes, you know, they're in the area and they will try different things. And
you know, Andrew.
Be very, very careful.
You know, Andrew, he's looking at a house out in Pennsylvania. Uh-huh. And the one thing I said is you can't leave your garbage out in garbage cans. And he says, I'm already on it. I'm going to build a like shed, you know, that's, you know, something that we can put it in, but it's going to be away from the house, so I don't have to smell the garbage, but the bears aren't going to go to it either, you know?
That's good.
And I says, that's brilliant thinking.
I want them to stay in the woods.
Yeah, yeah.
They're safe, too.
Yeah. But sharks, this shark week is going to start July what?
It's July 9th.
July 9th.
July 9th. It'll run through the following weekend. And we will, if anyone wants to go to our website, which is MatawanHistoricalSociety.org, we will be posting different types of information about what's going to be happening that week and any changes we have to our schedule. But we will have a schedule there for anyone who would like to mm-hmm. check out our website. And if they're available, we certainly would welcome them to come to our town.
And when the book comes out, you're not going to put it on Amazon or anything like this?
It may very well be, you know, further on down the line. I haven't done it as of yet. We're still kind mm-hmm. of in the early stages of that. But like I said, that I'm glad it's finished now. I'm glad it's out there, and I hope people will enjoy it. And I wrote it, like I said, as a as an act of love for history. And all the years that I've spent researching this, I wanted to be able to share with people before I pass on to the happy hunting grounds.
You sounded like Julie Adams just then. Remember Julie Adams from The Creature of the Black Lagoon? She wrote a book called The Lucky Southern Star, Julie Adams, Tales from the Black Lagoon. I says, what was the best thing about writing this book? And I'm thinking, you know, catharsis-wise, you know, what did... She says, finishing it.
Right.
That was the best moment when I finished
personal.
It.
You know, especially when you do a biography of someone, years of research, you feel like you really know them, like you're a friend of that person, you're connecting with that person, you're actually living experiences they did. I used to, you know, read about that and didn't think that was, you know, I thought it was an exaggeration. I found out it isn't an exaggeration. When you really get into, you know, writing a biography, it's like it becomes an obsession with you, and it's something that you do want to share with others. You know, when it involves certain values that people should learn about and should be very happy that they're still around.
You want to do right by them. You know, it's not when the difference between having an editor say, hey, we need another book from you, and you taking on the life of Stanley Fisher.
Exactly.
Is you want to do right by him. You're not just pumping something out for money. You want to make sure people understand this was a gentler age, an age when this young man saw a mother screaming on a bank of a creek and saying, we got to give her back a body. You know, kid's dead. We know the kid's dead, but look at his mother. We can't just not.
It's something that the people of the town felt they had to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it was they couldn't look the other way. They had to get involved. They had to do their best. And Stanley gave his life. There were other people who were in the water too, that were, you know, risking their lives.
Mm-hmm. And it could have been any one of them.
It's worth remembering.
Mm-hmm. It could have been any one of them, and it's something that I think we need to remind people of. I guess what your book does for me, and what the Matawan Society, Historical Society, and all does for me, is it makes me hopeful that we're passing on the more gracious parts of being humans, you know.
Exactly.
and remembering the good of the whole. You know, people watch Star Trek and they watch the movie the lives of the many outweigh the life of the one or the few, but they don't actually think that way. You know, it's just a great movie, and that's a great line. But Stanley Fisher actually understood what that meant.
Well, when you study history and you get beyond, you know, I was a teacher, so, you know, my whole life was devoted to this. When you try to explain to your students that it's not just learning, you know, names and dates and battles, you're learning about people.
Mm-hmm.
And when you learn about people who lived at different times, you realize that a lot of experiences they were involved in, they were different. But many of the same things are the same as we experience today, and what we have to, certain uncertainties in life we have to deal with. And there are certain character, you know, qualities in people that help them to face that type of a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And you can learn from others, and that's really what history is all about. When you see history that way, it's everything changes. And it's a very refreshing type thing when you've had a tough day and you want to just relax, and you read about something in history, an event that happened several hundred years ago, but it has meaning for you today, because those are real people too, and you can learn from their lives, and that's what makes it interesting.
Yeah, there is something you just said. There was a school in Lawrence Harbor, and it was back when I first met Teddy. And some people were changing to name the school something else. And people like Teddy, who had been there for a long time, said, do you understand that this guy would buy clothing for kids that their parents couldn't afford it? This guy paid for books. this guy is the reason the school was built. Do you understand how much this man did? But because you had newer people moving into the community who had no clue about its past, they said, well, let's change the name. I don't know why that's named that, you know? He said, you don't understand. This guy did so much for the kids in this town and for families. If he found out a family was in trouble and didn't have food, he'd go buy bags of food and just drop it off at the house. That's why the school is named for him. And it was named
after... That's what history is all about.
Yeah, and that's what history is. Finding out why things are the way they are. Who is this person, this name on this building? Or why is this monument in the middle of town? And that's what history is. And I wish people would embrace it more.
And it's certainly, it's refreshing to you, and it helps to enrich your life, and it's, everyone has to earn a living, everyone has to do different things in life, but sometimes you need a little bit of a break from that to refresh your own soul. Mm-hmm. I think that's what history can do, when you go to your books and you take that little break, and after it's over, you feel good. Mm-hmm. And you view things around you in a different way. And that's something special.
Right. And these are real people. These aren't friggin' makeup vampires and Brothers Grimm's characters. These are real people your book is about. The book is Stanley Fisher, Shark Attack Hero of a Bygone Age by John Allen Savolaine. He's going to have a book signing on June 30th at the Barnes & Noble in Freehold?
In the Eatontown Mall.
Eatontown Mall. And the book is going to be available through the Matawan Historical Society.org. You can find them on Facebook, too. I'm going to be putting links out. When will the book be available for people to order?
It will be very, very shortly.
Okay.
In fact, it's completed, it's printed, and we're in the process of organizing everything right now. But the book is here, and like I said, it's something that it was a work of love for me, years in the making, and I wanted to share things that were very meaningful to me, and I think others will feel the same way. It'll make them feel good about their town and the people around them.
The one thing I did before you leave, they're not sure they got the actual shark. At the end of it all, they're kind of sure, but they're not sure, right?
That's right. It's like anything else in history. There are going to be different views. There are going to be different possible solutions. And this happened in 1916, before, the advent of, having better ways of identification through DNA and things like that. And that's the only way that you could verify 100% that this was the shark that actually attacked Lester Stillwell, Stanley Fisher, Charles Bruder, Charles Van Zandt. That's the only way it could be done. It'll never happen. And you can have theories, you can believe this and that. That's what makes history interesting. Because there is no one set way. People, you can have your opinion, I can have my opinion, and we can both enjoy the study of history. Mm-hmm. And this is one of those cases where it is open-ended. It could be, or it could be something else.
Right. I've read that a lot of people said that they thought this guy that came up with this just faked it all to get the money, and that they never actually did get the shark. I want to thank you so much.
One thing that is interesting, though, the shark attacks stopped after this. They didn't continue. Mm-hmm. So one of the sharks that had been killed at that time may have been the culprit that was doing this, because it didn't happen after that. We don't know for sure. Maybe, like I said, with the Spanish influenza, it came on its own and left on its own.
Maybe it ate something that disagreed with it,
it could,
like a license plate. in the movie Jaws. What are you telling me? It ate a car? You know, oh, it came up from the Gulf Stream. Here's a license plate from Louisiana. I want to thank you so much for coming on the show, and I can't wait to get my hands on the book. And we'll be talking again, I'm sure, somehow. You know, I'm going to keep interviewing people as long as God lets me.
One thing I did want to say, Mo, is all the times that I've been on your show, and I've enjoyed the conversations, I've really enjoyed your probing questions, how you handle the topic, how you develop, you know, the information to help people better understand this. And I think everyone who listens to your show would agree with me that we've been very, very thrilled with everything that you've done in the past and look forward to what you'll be doing in the future.
Thank you so much. You know how I am. If it helps one person, I'm cool. You know, if it helps one person understand something a little bit better, that's the moon for me. That's wonderful for me. I'm going to let you go, and I'm going to end the show out with thanks for the memories. And
that's nice.
It's perfect, right? It's perfect. And thank you so much, and give a kiss to Kathy, and this will be on
that.
YouTube tomorrow.
And it's been a pleasure being on your show.
It's always a pleasure, and I'll see you at the festival or whatever you're calling this. What is it, a centennial?
It's a commemoration.
Commemoration.
A historical commemoration of an event that you know, that we hope people will learn about and understand. And,
yeah.
We don't, like I said, we don't celebrate in the traditional sense of celebrating,
right.
But it is important to remember, and that's what we're trying to do with this event.
They're saying thank you, John, for being a guest, and it's always very interesting. Matawan Historical Society has a Facebook. And they also have a website, and you can order John's book there. And it's the real story, not the make-up on that you see in the movies. This was a real story. It really happened, and people died, and people went out looking for a shark, and there were heroes, real heroes with real names, who have gone far too long without being recognized. All you have to do is hang up. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Mo. Take care.
God bless.
Bye. You too.
Bye. That's wonderful, and I can't think of a better way to end the show with Dream Stream than with John Al Savolaine, as we all call him, Al. And like I said, I'll be working over the summer on something, some idea of what I'm going to do. I'll still do interviews. Maybe I'll just do them and put them right on YouTube. Everybody likes YouTube. It seems to be one of the popular mediums. And I want to thank all of you for being so wonderful and so supportive. And the only way I can really do it is to play this song. And I love you all. God bless you all. God bless you and yours always.
For the memory of sentimental verse, nothing in my purse, and chuckles when the preacher said, for better or for worse,
how lovely it was. Thanks for the memory of Schubert serenade, little things of jade, and traffic jams and anagrams and bills we never paid.
How lovely it was. We who could laugh over big things were parted by only a slight thing.
I wonder if we did the right thing. Oh, well, that's life, I guess.
I love your dress.
Do you?
It's pretty.
Thanks for the memory of faults that you forgave, rainbows on a wave,
and stockings in the basin when a fellow needs a shave. Thank you so much.
thanks for the memory of tinkling temple bells, alma mater yell,
and Cuban rum and towels from the very best hotel.
Oh, how lovely it was. Thanks for the memory of cushions on the floor, hashed with Dinty Moore, that pair of gay pajamas that you bought and never wore.
Say, by the way, whatever became of those pajamas?
Huh? We said goodbye with a highball.
Then I got as high as a steeple.
Did you?
But we were intelligent people.
No tears, no fuss.
Hooray for us.
Strictly entre darling, how are you?
And how are all those little dreams that never did come true?
Awfully glad I met you.
Cheerio and toodaloo.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
For visiting me at my lair. And God bless you and yours. Ha, 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 ha.